Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 12th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee. Can I ask everyone in the room to ensure that their mobile phones are on silent? It's acceptable to use mobile devices for social media, but please don't take photographs or film proceedings. The first item on the agenda is subordinate legislation. We have one negative instrument. That instrument is the General Pharmaceutical Council Amendment of Miscellaneous Provisions Rules Order of Council 2016, SSI 2016-1008. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Could I invite any comments from members? Alison.
Yeah, if I may, convener, I think it is the case that previously only pharmacy professionals from outside the EEA were required to demonstrate appropriate knowledge of English, and new legislation has extended this requirement to professionals from European countries. Now, I just want to say that I fully appreciate that there's strong support from the health professions for this requirement and that patient safety is at the heart of it. But I'd just like to note that the Law Society have previously raised concerns. They noted in 2014 that the proposals for language controls for health professionals raise equality and discrimination issues and may give rise to issues of direct race discrimination, which can't be legitimised through the principle of proportionality. So I would just like to put on the record that I hope this requirement comes along with the adequate support for these professionals to learn English if required.
Okay, thank you. So that's now on the record, and hopefully that will be taken on board as this goes forward. Any other comments from members? No. Can we agree to make no recommendations? Thank you, that is agreed. The second item on the agenda is our third evidence session on mental health, and this session will focus on adult mental health services. We have a cast of thousands this morning, so I'll begin by introducing myself. I'm Neil Finlay, I'm the convener of the Health and Sport Committee and MSP for the Lothians. If we could go in this direction and people just briefly introduce yourself, not your biography, just a brief introduction.
I'm Bob Leslie, I'm the Chair of the Social Work Scotland Mental Health Subgroup representing Social Work Scotland, and I manage mental health officer services for Renfrewshire Council.
I'm Claire Hawkey, I'm Deputy Convener of the Health and Sport Committee, and I'm the MSP for Rutherglen.
I'm Tom Arthur, I'm the MSP for Renfrewshire South.
I'm Carolyn Lockhead, I'm the Public Affairs Manager at SAMH.
I'm Miles Briggs, Conservative MSP for Lothian.
I'm Chris O'Sullivan, I'm from the Mental Health Foundation.
Donald Cameron, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Andrew Fraser, Director of Public Health Science at NHS Health Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Alex Cole-Hamilton. I'm MSP for Edinburgh Weston. I'm also the Lib Dem Health Spokesperson.
Alison Johnston, MSP for Lothian.
Morning, Richard Lyle, MSP for Uddingston and Belsall.
Good morning, Colin Mackay, the Chief Executive of the Mental Welfare Commission.
Marie Todd, MSP for the Highlands and Islands. I'm also a pharmacist specialising in mental health.
Morning, I'm Lucy Mulvey, Director of Policy and Communications at the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, and we're also co-conveners of the Health and Social Care Action Group of Scotland's National Action Plan for Human Rights.
I'm Colin Smith, MSP for South Scotland.
I'm Alistair Cook, Chair of the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland and of the Scottish Mental Health Partnership.
Ivan McKee, MSP for Glasgow Proven.
Okay, thank you. We're due to be joined by Wendy McCausland, who will just join us when she arrives. Okay, could we begin? Alec, would you like to begin?
Convener, good morning to everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning. At the end of last year, our earlier mental health strategy kind of expired, and we've been treading water with that ever since. We've now received, obviously, a draft strategy which is being consulted on. I wonder if the panel can give us their reflections on what the opportunity cost, if any, there has been of the delay in producing a draft strategy, and whether they think that this answers the challenge of mental health in our society in terms of what they see in the draft strategy.
Who would like to kick us off?
I'll start. I think that we have We've worked with a number of partners in looking at the strategy over a good period of time in the Scottish Mental Health Partnership. I think that the delay is probably less of a concern to us than the at the moment our perception of what was in the engagement document as a lack of ambition within the proposals that have been brought forward by Scottish Government. I think we would rather see time taken to get a strategy that is really right for the time that we have now in Scotland, and that really produces a transformation in where the mental health services are going in Scotland. At the moment, I think the engagement document has tended to focus, as previous strategies have, on how we make mental health services as they exist at the moment better. And absolutely behind that, and think that that's really important that we need to do that. But I think the partnership and stakeholders across Scotland would want to see if we're genuinely looking at a 10-year vision for mental health, something that takes us beyond good mental health services and starts to look at how we improve the mental health of the population of Scotland, and that how we begin to identify what we can do at local and national level to produce better mental health across our whole communities. And there's a whole lot of things that can help us to do that. NHS Health Scotland have co-produced with the COSLA the document Good Mental Health for All, which I think is a really helpful document in directing us some of the way. The other area that I think that we would push for in terms of the strategy is that if we're going to do some of this, then we need to be really thinking about whether there's a commitment at government level to resource that mental health strategy as well as produce that. So there's a couple of opening areas that we'd be keen to discuss.
Just if I may convene, just to follow up on that, I'm grateful to you for that. I think everybody would agree that we don't want to rush out a strategy if it's the wrong one. That lack of ambition that you describe, and is that primarily characterised by the barrier of resources, do you think? Or, I mean, is this a cash issue?
No, I think it's both. I think the there's a lack of ambition in a sense that I think what was set out in the consultation document at this stage was a series of actions, most of which we would support, but that didn't have an overarching aim or objective behind that. I think the lack of resource is a particular pressure. It's a pressure across all health services, of course, at the moment, but what we are seeing, certainly in recent years, has been that in terms of efficiency savings both within health service and within local authorities are being applied across the board, and the new money that's been identified that coming into mental health services goes nowhere near matching the efficiency savings that are coming out. And boards naturally tend to respond to the pressures which are placed upon them to where the urgent need for money is, and that tends to focus in on the acute services. So I think overall we would see that the proportion of spend within health and social services on mental health, it certainly feels like it's dropping, and I don't have the figures to give you that ideal because it's difficult to get accurate figures around that, but certainly there's a sense that proportion of spend is dropping across mental health and social care services.
I think if I'm right, the proportion has dropped from something like 12% 5 years ago to nearer 9% now. Do you have a sort of figure? I mean, the GPs ask for 11%. Is there a figure that you would have in mind on that?
No, I don't have a specific figure in mind.
Could I bring in Caroline?
Thank you. Just in terms of the question about whether this meets the challenge of what we need from a new mental health strategy, I think there are things that are looking positive in the draft that we've seen. Before the election, we asked for a 10-year strategy. We've had 3-year strategies in the recent past, and we were pushing for a 10-year strategy, which we've got and we're very glad of. And I think the 8 priorities that were in the engagement document were good and we would support them. There are additional things that we would like to see, which we'll no doubt get onto. Particularly, we're keen to see something more on employment, more on primary care, and more on psychological therapies particularly. I think the approach overall that we are really looking for, prior to the election we talked a lot about the idea of an ask once, get help fast approach, and that came from when we spoke to people who were in need of a mental health service of some kind. Often what we hear is, do you know what, the service is generally quite good once you get into it. That's not uniformly the case, but it's something that we hear quite often. But it's actually getting to the right service or the right support that is the difficulty. And that's why we, Alistair mentioned the need for more ambition and more of a vision, which we definitely, we really want to see a clear vision for this strategy. And for us, that should be about transforming the culture of mental health, not just in services, but really broadly, so that at any point when you need help, whether that's in a health service, in school, in employment, you are able to take that ask once, get help fast approach, so that you don't have... It takes a lot of courage to seek help for a mental health problem, and you shouldn't have to summon up that courage more than once. You should be able to be rooted to the right source of help when you first ask, and we hope that this new strategy will really help to transform culture so that that becomes the case.
In the NHS Scotland evidence, they say estimates suggest that only 1 in 4 with significant symptoms of mental health problems are receiving treatment. Clearly, that is not happening. Chris.
Thank you very much, Convener. And thanks for the question. One of the challenges that we foresee, and I should explain to the committee, we are a national charity focusing on prevention in mental health. And one of the great opportunities with a decade-long plan is that you can play the medium to long-term game, and that is where prevention sits. We firmly believe that addressing mental health across policy areas is a skeleton key that can unlock quite a few of the challenges that we face in Scotland in the years going forward. And I know that the Mental Health Partnership shares that. So a jewel in the crown of doing that should be equitable, accessible mental health services which are based on a human rights-based approach and enable people to get help and move through that help onto recovery. You would think that that was a simple ask. It's not necessarily, and we've worked to do there. But equally, we would very much like to see a 10-year strategy which focused both resource and ambition across policy areas, including places like justice, in children's work, taking forward some of the excellent progress which has been made in the likes of GERFEC and others, and in some of the strategies in relation to ageing and working life, and orienting those around mental health. We felt to an extent that mental health policy has been somewhat orphaned in the last two iterations of policy within a very specific set of civil servants within the government, and we would like to see a strategy which firmly placed responsibility for addressing mental health across government as an asset for Scotland going forward.
Andrew.
To build on points we've heard already, this is not so much a mental health strategy as a mental health service strategy, and as such, it's quite adequate. I think there's more could be perhaps done on primary care. But if we're looking at a mental health strategy, we need to go upstream to the prevention elements. We need to widen the vision. And just as Chris says, look in other areas. And there's plenty of other areas where if we built on them or we took seriously and went about the business of implementation much more enthusiastically and comprehensively, we would yield mental health gains, such as parenting interventions, serious attention to bullying in schools, and heading on through the life course, you know, good work and fulfilling work and policies that are enlightened there, social inclusion at community level, and back to Chris's point about justice, there's some people who are in serious trouble where we have good evidence that support for people with complex co-occurring problems, including mental health problems, is effective. Homelessness, I would highlight too, people at real risk there with very grim health indices, and this floor of rights, human rights underneath it. So I think the strategy could borrow but also build on some of these elements from policy areas other than health in order to create a vision which is ambitious.
Lucy.
Just to come back on a couple of points that were made in terms of the time that's been taken, and I would, you know, agree with people that have said We welcome the fact that the strategy has been extended to 10 years. I mean, although ideally it would be even longer than that, given that mental health is something that we want to address through the life course. And the other thing that we welcomed was the really quite explicit focus on human rights and the rights-based approach. And I think that is very welcome, given that it was only one of the commitments really in the previous strategy. And I think if you're to look at achieving transformational change and a rights-based approach, we do need to nurture that, and that will need to take some time. One of the things, though, that we've picked up on is that we're a bit concerned at the focus in the strategy on only two particular elements of the rights-based approach. Some people use the panel principles: participation, accountability, non-discrimination, empowerment and legality. And in the vision document, they particularly pulled out only a couple of those. And one of the things that we would think is really, though, is that they're interdependent, these five elements of a rights-based approach. And particularly in mental health, accountability is incredibly important, as well as the legality aspect. And I know that in the Commission's response, you've picked up on points around the mental health legislation. And again, we would think that in the future, one of the things the strategy could look to doing would be to review and revise mental health legislation to be more in line with international human rights standards, for example, the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities.
Mr. Greener, thank you. I'd echo some of the sentiments around the table. Social Work Scotland feel that the strategy, whilst welcome, is not really transformational enough and is very service-led. And despite having an integral role in the support of people with mental health, social work isn't mentioned in the strategy, nor is the role of the mental health officer, who has a very important role in protecting the rights of the individual at very vulnerable times in their life when they may be about to be placed under statutory measures of care. And as already been said, some of the key groups in society, such as those involved with the criminal justice system, are sadly not mentioned. And equally, the strategy is not embedded in current policy and legislation, and links to things like GIRFIC, self-directed support, the integration agenda of health and social care, will impact its ability to be delivered in its current form. Many of the IJBs, the strategy is intended to inform the help and strategic planning for the IJBs, but many children's services and criminal justice services sit out with the structure of the IJBs, and our colleagues in Highland Council and NHS Highland have a completely different model of management and structure. So there are a number of challenges around, and that's really just an opening position from SWS.
Go on.
Sorry, struggling to come up with anything new after that. But I mean, obviously we generally agree with those. I think make a couple of points. I mean, one about how you do the strategy. If you are genuinely talking about a 10-year vision, and I think I would generally echo the view that there's quite a lot that's welcome in this, but it does feel like a 3-year mental health services plan rather than a 10-year vision. And in a way, that's not surprising if you kind of set out to produce that in a matter of weeks, because it's a difficult thing to do to produce a 10-year vision. And it almost seems almost a kind of constitutional point that it's, if you're genuinely talking about a vision, a transformational vision that's going to survive 2 or 3 parliaments, it doesn't seem to me to be right that you, as it were, produce the current government kind of produces it more or less within St Andrew's House and then says, is this okay, guys? That actually what you need to do is have a much more substantive dialogue and engagement with people who use mental health services, the wider community, and the people affected by the things that make people mentally unwell, such as poverty and so on. And in fact, the government, you know, in other aspects of its work, has done a lot to kind of commit to broader public engagement. You know, it recently, Scottish Government is at the United Nations kind of joining up on developing citizen participation, and it just doesn't seem that approach has fed enough into this. It does feel like something that we really should commit to doing something transformational over a long time frame, and that should be done in a different way. The other comment I'd like to make initially is just picking up on the rights point, which Lucy particularly mentioned. And I mean, all policies should be rights-based, and I think there's a lot in the SHRC submission on a human rights-based approach, which I think is very helpful in terms of fleshing out the kind of ideas about the panel approach, about what that would actually entail. But I just want to make the particular point that this is the only group of people for whom who live in the shadow of coercion, and I think that's really, really important when you're talking about a mental health strategy, that ultimately some people will be given care and treatment that they don't want or didn't ask for, and that's different from everybody else who accesses health and social care. And you can't have a mental health strategy which doesn't actually acknowledge that. Now, there are elements in the current document which say something about that. But that's an area where I think, and we might get a chance to expand on this later, but just briefly say, Scotland, about 10 years ago, Scotland was probably world leading in terms of a rights-based approach to mental health care and treatment, genuinely world leading. And you will speak to people in Northern Ireland, people in Australia, people in Canada, who say we all learned from what Scotland did in the early 2000s. We're not world leading anymore. And I think, you know, if you look at something like Northern Ireland, who've just passed very radical mental health and capacity legislation, there is a chance for us to be world leading again. But if you're looking, certainly if you're looking 10 years out, I would find it difficult to imagine that we say in 10 years' time the legal framework that was devised in the late 90s is actually the framework that you'd want in the light of the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities and other things. So part of a 10-year strategy, I think, has to be looking reasonably fundamentally at what the framework is for compulsory care and treatment.
Colin, I'm looking around the table, who would know this, but I'm looking at you. In terms of the draft, was that produced by somebody sitting in an office in St Andrew's House, or was there a working group, or were you people consulted beforehand before that draft saw the light of day?
There was engagement. I mean, I think it's true that the government discussed with was engagement. Well, they came and spoke.
Some
to
engagements
people.
Last a while, others last a while short.
As I understand the process, and certainly as we were involved in the process, I think officials from the Mental Health Division came out and spoke to various people. There were a couple of events. I remember an event in the hotel on opposite St Andrew's House. So there were a couple of kind of general events involving kind of some stakeholders and I think some one-on-one discussions. And as I say, some
that,
of what...
Is that what you would have expected to have happened?
I think that's helpful, but as I say, in the context of a 10-year vision, I think I would have expected something a bit more structured and substantive than that.
Alistair.
Not too defensive of the division, but they are saying that the document produced for consultation at that point was very much an engagement document, and there was some input leading up to it. I understand that they've had well over 600 responses to that document and are now working their way through those and are producing a draft strategy based on that information rather than a further process. Yeah. But I understand that we still expect to see the strategy before Christmas.
Yeah, we'd always expect any draft to be commented on and critiqued, but it does seem as though this one has missed the mark pretty widely. Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I touch on the issue of waiting times? Obviously, the Scottish Government has set a maximum waiting time target of 18 weeks from a patient's referral to treatment for psychological therapies. And obviously, the aim is for that to be met in the case of at least 90% of patients. Now, for the quarter end in June 2016, the figures show that it was only met in the case of 81.2% of people. So can I ask the panel why they think that target was missed, and do you support the call, which I think was made by Sam H, for an inquiry into the failure to meet those particular targets? And just one final point, later in the agenda we'll be considering a petition which calls for the target to be reduced, and I'm interested to get the panel's views on whether they think the target should be reduced.
Karen?
Thank you. The target to see people who've been referred for psychological therapies within 18 weeks is a really important one. And it's one that, as you say, Currently, only 81% of people are being seen within that target, and that figure has been broadly static for quite a while. Within that, there's five health boards who are currently meeting the target. There's a lot that we can learn from looking into those statistics a little bit more. For example, we know that Glasgow and Ayrshire and Arran are dealing with quite notably more referrals per head of population than other health boards are. And I would like to see, well, you won't be surprised to learn that we support the call for an independent inquiry into why these targets haven't been met, given that we made that call. But beyond that, I think there's a lot more that we can learn. These stats come out very regularly. So we would like to know more about why are, particularly Glasgow, which is one of the health boards that is meeting the target, why are Glasgow able to do that, given that they are dealing with more referrals per head of population? We would like to know more about what specifically what therapies are being provided. We did some FOIs a couple of years ago now, and what we found was that the majority of health boards couldn't tell us much about, for example, equalities data. So we don't really know if different equalities groups are getting more or less access to psychological therapies, and we would question why health boards aren't collecting that, or at least aren't aggregating that in a way that they can then review. They weren't really collecting, again, at an aggregate level, details of the therapies that were being provided, so they couldn't really tell us what they were providing. And obviously that is recorded at the individual level. But again, if that's not being reviewed at a board level, we would question, well, how do you know what you need to plan for? So I think there's a lot more information that we would like to understand in terms of what's the good practice that's happening now and what we can learn. There is good practice happening in England. The Increasing Access to Psychological Therapies programme seems to be getting good results. I would note that they are seeing 61% of people within 28 days. They have invested in creating 3,000 new therapists. There's quite a lot of funding going into that. So there's a lot that I would like to see us look at in terms of what we can learn. The engagement paper talks about rolling out computerised CBT for people as part of helping to meet the target, which is important. Computerised CBT has an evidence base and can work for many people, but there are also other approaches that have an equivalent evidence base, such as one-to-one CBT, such as things like behavioural activation. And in the interests of choice, we would like to see those approaches that do have just as strong an evidence base being rolled out. So there's a lot we can look at. We know that there are a lot of people who were waiting at the end of the last quarter. I think it was 18,000 people were waiting to start treatment at the end of the last quarter. So there's a lot of people waiting for these services. There's a lot that we need to learn. We would like to see the target come down to be 12 weeks so that it is more in line with other health service targets. We're not sure why it should be higher in mental health. And just to address your last part of the question about do we support the target continuing, we are doing a bit of policy work internally at the moment to inform our position on the targets review, which you took evidence on recently. So we haven't reached a final view on that. At the moment, we are wary of the idea that we might lose targets in mental health because they do drive investment and they do drive improvement, but we accept that there is possibly something better that we could do if we took a wider approach, particularly, I think, on the psychological therapies target, where we know a great deal about how long people are waiting and you know the points in the journey that they go on, but we don't really know, you know, does anyone feel better at the end of it and what's helped and what hasn't helped. So we think the target could be improved, but we hope that we don't move away entirely from it without giving it some careful thought.
Colin, do you want to come back in on that?
Okay? No, I think it's pretty comprehensive. Okay. It'd be interesting to see what others think.
Lucy?
Yeah, I just wanted to just pick up on a couple of points that Carolyn made, is that I think we're encouraged by the new national targets review in the sense that they say they're going to take a wider approach rather than looking at just sort of a numbers and percentages games of waiting times, because of course while waiting times are incredibly important, it's also incredibly important to know more about what the quality of the care is, what that people are actually receiving once they do get access to support and services, and what the outcomes are for them. So we're very keen to see that there are, you know, increasing measurements around personal outcomes, approaches and so on. And again, I mean, I know I'm probably a bit of a stuck record in this, but we do think that taking a rights-based approach and actually, you know, if we were look at taking a transformative approach to mental health and building it on a framework of rights, then that would be something that would actually help to underpin a lot of a values based around outcomes, empowerment of people, participation in decision making and things like that, rather than just a narrow focus on, as I said, percentages and numbers, really.
Alison, did you want to come in?
It wasn't particularly on that issue.
Okay,
but
we'll come back to you then.
Okay, thank you.
Any other members on this issue? Miles, I think you were. No? Okay. Ivan.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Yeah, it was just on that area around about targets, and there is obviously this focus on this 18-week target. I suppose my question is, around the panel, considering that in the round, is that the right thing to measure? Should we be measuring other things as well? For example, what we hear is if there was more focus spent on what's happening at Tier 2, you might be fixing a lot of issues there in advance and they don't get as bad and they don't have to go to Tier 3. Is there an issue around about if you divert resources to having that first appointment, but then the rest of the process through Tier 3 isn't focused the way it should be? Is there something in there? And then you measure the quality, obviously, of the outcome as well is important. I mean, all these things can be measured. You can use numbers to measure them. And should we have a broader range of number-driven targets on some other aspects in addition to what's there at the moment?
I think we've welcomed over the last decade, actually, since these targets were first talked about and brought in through Delivering for Mental Health, the fact that there are targets in mental health, because what that's done is it's brought mental health onto the agenda at health board level and in other places. I'm not sure that the current targets are sophisticated enough to be able to drive the sorts of change that we want. What they have done, and they've been hugely successful in this, is increase the numbers and availability of psychological therapies and of CAMHS therapies. But as gentleman to my right here said, what we've seen in CAMHS in particular is that there's an expansion in the Tier 3 services, but that's meant that it's more difficult for CAMHS services to be able to do work with schools and do other things, which is actually a huge part of what they ought to be able to do. In terms of psychological therapies, we see fewer psychologists and others with psychological therapy skills working in our community mental health teams with individuals with severe and enduring mental health problems, because the resource within psychological therapy services is very much moved towards meeting the target, because that's the priority. So while supporting the need for targets within mental health, because it keeps it on the agenda, I think we need to be much more sophisticated in how we look at those targets and really start to think about how they improve outcomes rather than focusing so much on the numbers.
Okay, Bob?
Yeah, I think the focus on targets is a good thing in some respects, because it has driven access to certain services that there was a problem with. However, the danger with the target is that we do see the delivery of services almost on a wide basis of one size fits all. We develop a programme of CBT or a particular intervention in an area, and that's what people get offered, and it actually doesn't address the individual's individual need and outcome that they're looking for. And I think we have to be cautious about targets, that they don't always deliver what we might wish them to deliver.
Hey, Chris.
Two things. One, we would certainly support an equity between targets in mental health and in other areas of health, because it reduces people's perception of mental health being somehow different. And secondly, at both ends of the prevention scale, access to psychological therapies is very important. It's important that people get rapid access at a first episode of a mild to moderate mental health problem when they need it, because it enables them to continue in their job, in their caring responsibilities and all the other things, and helps, for example, workplaces to see recovery from a sort of transient episode of mental health problems. Critical at the other end of the spectrum as well, though, and not just in terms of first access. And we need to also understand how people with ongoing mental health problems have access to psychological therapies and how they're used. And I think there's certainly scope within a 10-year strategy to do some real user journey research about how people use services of all kinds at different points and how that interacts with the targets that are set from time to time.
Okay. Sorry, just one point in relation to targets and stuff. You know, if we want to change things, what should we be reporting on and measuring and counting? Yeah, Colin.
Well, I think this is the thing about rights and outcomes, because of course all targets will, as a kind of sort of measures, access to one particular kind of intervention, which may or may not be the right intervention for you. I mean, my sense of a kind of 10-year vision is actually the role of government and the role of the kind of parliament is to set a kind of ambition in terms of outcomes, in terms of what we want to change in people's lives. Now, exactly how that change is delivered will change over time, and there may be different ways in which you achieve outcomes for people, and some of that may be about people having greater choice for themselves about what would help them achieve an outcome. So, you know, it may not be that, you know, a particular psychological therapy is the particular thing that's going to make a difference for a particular person. I mean, I think targets certainly have a use if you're saying there's clear underinvestment in a particular area of care in the health service or in the social care system, so therefore we as a government or we as a parliament are going to make sure that there's a change in that. I mean, that's a legitimate short-term aim to set a target. But I think what you should be setting in terms of, say, the broad ambition is a sense of what the outcomes are for people, and get the system to work out how to deliver those outcomes and to do that in a way which actually responds to what people want. And this is where some of the things that have been tried over the last few years, like self-directed support, are all about that. They're all about people saying, this is what would actually make the difference for me. This is the thing that would actually allow me to live a flourishing life rather than just live some kind of fairly impoverished existence. But actually, some of these things like self-directed support, although people with mental health problems could be the ideal customers of those because their needs can be quite individual, they can fluctuate, they haven't really worked for people with mental health problems because problems around access and the way that systems are designed. So I think if you set an ambition which actually is about services responding to people's own sense of how they can get well and how they can maintain good mental health, that would allow the system to be more responsive rather than just responding to centrally set targets.
Don't know if you meant to say customers or not, but I that just sits very wrong with me that we regard people with mental health problems as customers. But anyway, could it
say customers? No, I wouldn't say customers.
Well, you did. I'm saying you maybe inadvertently said it, but you did. Sorry. Could I raise just a couple of things? If 3 out of 4 people weren't being treated for a broken leg, and if so many people were dying decades before they should, would there be an outcry if they weren't? If it was a physical condition, I don't understand why there's not an outcry around these figures. And are those the things that we should be measuring? People's life expectancy and access to services. 3 out of 4, according to the submission from Colin's organisation, saying 3 out of 4 are not getting the treatment. I find that absolutely astonishing. So is that the type of things that you think we should be recording and analysing? Lucy?
Yeah, I mean, I would agree. It is absolutely outrageous. And I just wanted to come in, you know, on the question of what should we be measuring. And I think the thing is, sometimes when we talk about rights and recovery, they can seem like quite ethereal, theoretical level things, or they're to do with courts and legal action and so on. But actually, there are existing tools that have been created at an international level, but for in-country use, around how you can indicators on rights and recovery within mental health service settings. For example, there's the World Health Organization's Quality Rights Toolkit, and also the UN, the United Nations, has you know, come up with a list, a suite of indicators that you can use to measure people's enjoyment of the right to the highest attainable standard of health, the right to an adequate standard of living, health, housing, etc., etc., and so on. So there are things that already exist out there that we could be using and adapting for a Scottish context to take into account the realities of our national situation here. So just wanted to contribute that.
Yeah, Chris?
Yeah, I would certainly agree with you, convener. It would be wonderful if we could monitor the absence of outcry and to produce that outcry. And actually, when you were on your previous point, many moons ago, when Vox was first set up, the conference we put together to co-design Vox was called User, Consumer, Survivor, Refuser. Because of the different senses of identity that people with mental health problems have in the world. And one of the challenges we face is giving a voice to some of the most voiceless people in our society. People like me who've had mental health problems and who have agency and control and education and can come and stand before committees is one thing. But there are legion people experiencing compound inequalities, complex trauma, who have no voice and are furthest away from agency. So if we could begin to monitor some of their experiences, some of the injustice that people experience, probably through some quite detailed and quite intelligent research, that could be extremely useful. And Colin brought up self-directed support as something that we've tried. Self-directed support is something which is in law. People are legally entitled to self-directed support. And yet we find time and time again that people with mental health problems are unable to access self-directed support, either because they don't meet eligibility criteria or because in some cases they're told that self-directed support doesn't apply in mental health. And that to me smacks of systematic discrimination, and that needs to be addressed. And it comes back to the point that I made earlier on, which I think is extremely important. And that is that your experience of mental health services and the support that should be available to you should be consistent no matter where you are in Scotland, no matter which board, no matter which local authority, and indeed if you move between boards and are mobile between things. And there are some places in Glasgow where you can move between two boards very easily. There are places in Edinburgh where you can move between two streets and move teams and you get a completely different experience. So we need to have a certain set of consistency across the piece.
Thank you. Implicit in the strategy, returning to the strategy for a moment, it does want mental health care to take its place alongside other types of health and disease. So I think implicit in its ambition is a wish for it to move up to live alongside physical health conditions, and you know, for that broken leg to be just every bit as important, and access to treatment for mental health conditions to be every bit as urgently and competently addressed. I think the question to us is how? And yes, there are all these service responses we've been talking about, access to services, the right style of services. But I think we need to look in a strategy also at the causes of these illnesses. And it goes back to what we want to achieve. Back to points made earlier about outcomes, as well as access and experience of services, but also these reasons why people become ill and are unable to climb out of despair or distress, because we know the scale of these things, we know ways out of them. I think we need to apply that as part of a broader strategy than looking at the health and sometimes social care implications.
Claire.
Thank you. Thank those who contributed, those organisations that contributed written reports to the committee this week. They've been particularly helpful, in particular the NHS Scotland report, which looked at health inequalities and the impact of social determinants in health. And as you might be aware, one of the strands of this committee's strategic plan is to test health policy and health strategy against inequality and how it helps to address health inequalities. And we've heard about we need to address this, we need to do something, but I'd like to hear what witnesses suggest can be done to help reduce some of the health inequalities and social inequalities experienced by those who have mental health problems. And I have to declare an interest here in that I am a registered mental health nurse.
Andrew, yeah.
It's me again, but we set out in our NHS Health Scotland submission a number of these areas. I think the challenge that we've been set by people who've looked at it is not just as of areas of high level intent and ambition, but what are the things we're going to do? And I think that's, I mean, assuming people are familiar with what we've said, what can we go on to say about the interventions? And I think we cannot dodge the issue of people's means, their about income and poverty and the stigma that comes along with not being able to afford things for yourself or for your child. We've done things like the cost of the school day. Now, that may be loosely related to mental health, but if you can't afford to have your children go out to school looking the way that all other children do and being able to afford the basic things that other children do, that's not good for mental well-being. And that's only the start. That's we're dealing with school age. So we need to look at fundamentals like that. I've mentioned before things like the school ethos, the effectiveness of schools. We are dealing in other areas of policy with attainment, and I've said before about bullying. So there are specific interventions about around school, and then we get into working age and older age and so on. There are things we can do to prevent mental illness occurring on a very large scale if we get these things right for the whole population. Now, we are aware that mental illness is banked up amongst particularly the poorest in our society, but it's not only there. It is amongst all areas, but particularly represented in the poorest, people with least means and least feeling they've got power over their lives and their circumstances. So we need to put mental well-being in that context. So that was the basis of our submission. But I think we do need to rise the challenge as an agency, along with other colleagues who are service providers, as well as policy-linked people, to see what is that going to be, what is that going to look like, and clothe the vision with interventions towards outcomes that really mean things for people.
Foster.
I think it would be hugely helpful if, as part of a 10-year strategy, we had an aim to reduce that gap in life expectancy between people with mental health problems and people without. That would be something, and it would drive a whole load of behaviours. But if you start to think, coming onto Claire's point, start to think about what actually works, you actually need to go quite far back. So we're talking about preconception, we're talking about support during pregnancy, we're talking about then perinatal period, we're then talking about childhood and what can be done in schools. And it begins to touch on your issue about, so what about the three quarters who aren't seeking help? In a sense, what we need to be able to do is to develop in our communities a much greater confidence and resilience at that young age, so that people are more able to self-manage if they can't prevent some of these things. So there's very much something about general education within our population about awareness of mental health. We all have mental health all of the time, and just some days it's better than others, and for some people it's worse for a long period of time and needs to be supported. It's a general level of population awareness, but then also targeting specific groups where we know there are risks. So high-risk families, as I say, children as they go through the school period, and then identifying people who are developing serious mental health conditions at the earliest possible stage, so that we can help them with we know that the early mortality is largely caused by excess smoking, obesity, alcohol, and drug use within those groups, as well as some impact of suicide and other areas. That's where the early mortality comes from. We need to intervene early before those sort of hopeless and helpless behaviours set in with people with serious mental health problems. So early intervention, childhood stuff, perinatal, and greater community awareness of mental health across the piece, and you begin to get an ambition for where we should go in the next 10 years.
Alison?
I'd probably like to address my question to Dr. Cook. In your submission, you say you've touched upon it there too, we need to consider how we plan our communities with a view to improving mental health and what support employers can offer workforces in improving mental health. And we know how workplace stress affects far too many people, and that welfare services need to be designed in a way that respects the needs of those with mental health difficulties. The other committee I sit on in Parliament is Social Security, and there's a huge interlap here and between these services. So could you just expand on what you'd like to see happen in our communities, in our workplaces, and with welfare services?
Okay. It's already been touched on by other members who've come along today, is that bit about we need to get much greater mental health awareness across all policies and all our thinking across policies. In particular, I think there'll be opportunities coming through the Community Empowerment Act, which means that we're starting to look at how community planning partnerships function and work. I'm not sure how much, I don't get a sense that community planning partnerships really have much awareness of the mental health impact of what's happening in local communities. So we could start to look at that. We should certainly be, when looking at any work that those planning partnerships do with employers, and saying how mentally healthy policies within those employers should be encouraged and supported. And similarly then, as we look at the welfare situation. So it comes back to that bit. If you look at almost any policy area, you will find that there is an impact and a potential impact, potential positive impact as well as negatives, on mental health. It's about identifying that and using that.
I think, if I might, Dr. Fraser, you touched in your submission on, you know, limited control being associated with an increased risk to mental health. And I think that's, you know, that can be about if you're on a 0 hours contract and you've got no control over your working hours, or if, you know, if things are being planned for your community and your view isn't really being taken account of. Clearly, we're ignoring the impact of some of these decisions and life circumstances on our mental health. Is there anything that you'd like to see this committee particularly highlighting to government as we go forward? And one other thing, you also speak in your submission about introducing a minimum income for healthy living. I think that would make a huge difference. Could you expand on that point too?
Sum up at the end, that the point you're making about the one thing or whatever, could we maybe do that in a round at the end? Is that just hope
certainly.
That's helpful?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just to give people time to think about it.
Okay, to address your two issues, this issue of control, Alice has already touched on community empowerment and the values within that. I could touch also on the consultation on social security, which is going around at the moment. The values underneath that are laudable. It is operationalising these things to say, what does that mean at a day-to-day level? We recognise that the fundamental causes of health and other inequalities are around income, wealth and power. And power is the most difficult one to sort of operationalise, if you like. But it is about, at the individual level, feeling as if you've got a say in your treatment, Colin's point, at community level, feeling you've got a say in the well-being of the community, that's a basic level of assets around it so that you can engage and build on them. At a democratic level, that there is local and national democracy and accountability there. But it's the general value of accountability in services, which Lucy pointed out under the human rights framework, which really would unlock the key to power empowerment if we created that value in services and supports for everyone, but particularly people who are most vulnerable. Intensive intervention, we have evidence, intensive interventions for people with complex problems are cost effective and lift people out of the position they're in. On your other area of interest in minimum income, yes, if people had sufficient income to set their children out to school, confident that they would cope materially with the cost of the school day, as we call it. That's just an example of how people can get on with life. If people can socialise and know that they can take their place in social situations with supported by a minimum income, which is more than we're talking about at the moment in terms of minimum income, we would see mental health gains. We would see health gains generally, because it would mean the evening up of income and income differentials. And it's not just about narrowing inequalities. The health dividend there is undoubted.
Thank
Really, just to come back a bit on the point I was making earlier on about health inequalities, and you've, I suppose you have addressed a little bit there, Dr. Fraser, about what I was going to ask about what measures we can put in place to reduce the inequalities in terms of the mortality rates for people who have mental health problems, and perhaps some other members of the panel would be able to expand on that. I know Dr. Cook spoke about alcohol and smoking as one of the main issues.
I've got a number of people who want to come in, so can I have Lucy then, Carolyn?
Just to pick up on the point about inequalities and reducing mortality and pick up on some of the comments that Alistair made, there's increasing focus here in Scotland on something called ACEs, Adverse Childhood Experiences, which is a trauma-informed approach, which has seen incredible results in America, for example, and there's increasing interest in it here. In fact, Health Scotland are running a national conference on Monday next week that's been chaired by Sir Michael Marmot on ACEs and looking at various evidence, little projects here and there around the country that's doing it. And what that does is it basically looks at, you know, what happened to you as a child. There's a set of, I think, 10 questions in the basic questionnaire. Depending on where your score is in that, it then, you know, can kind of say, well, your life chances of acquiring diabetes, cancer, whatever, irrespective of the then very natural so-called risky behaviour that you might go on to take, such as smoking, using alcohol and drugs, as a natural response to the trauma that you've had in childhood. But coupled with work, as Alistair picked up on, working around strengths and resilience and asset-based approaches, and again, there are some great examples in Scotland of work being done in those areas, we can look to try and overcome this. But it is an intergenerational approach, and it will take time. It's also a very good approach because it seeks to address a whole person, not just within health and social care services or within mental health services, but it's also about tackling it in schools, in the criminal justice system, in local community centres and so on. So I think that's one thing, that's one practical thing that we could do. Another, I think, is co-production as a rights-based approach. Co-producing responses, strategies such as the mental health strategy, strategies that are going to address other inequalities, actually meaningfully, actively engaging the people who are affected by this in listening to their experiences and basing our responses to them on what works for them already in a meaningful way, again, I think is another practical thing that we can do. And there's encouraging signs in the social security consultation, for example, that, you know, there's been a heck of a lot of engagement going on in that. But co-producing is more than just engaging or consulting with people. It's about getting people in a room, sitting down with them, and they draft this thing alongside the people in the civil service or on various committees, whatever. So I guess I would say, what can this committee do? Take more evidence from the people who are at the sharp end of this and listen to what's happening in their lives and what's important and what works for them.
Hey, Carolyn, and hey, Chris.
2 points from me on the issue of tackling inequalities. So they are employment and stigma. We know that in general, good work is good for your mental health most of the time if you are well enough to work. And that's something that we would really like to see a lot of in the next strategy. So in the draft, the discussion document, it does talk about making sure that the new employment programmes in Scotland reflect or involve mental health. But we think we need to see a lot more on that. We know that if you have a severe mental health problem, you are very likely to be unemployed. About half of the people who are on employment and support allowance receive it on the basis of a mental health problem. And we know that if you are employed in a job where you have a reasonable amount of control and a sense of satisfaction, that is generally good for your mental health as long as you are well enough to work. So we think that's a really important area for the mental health strategy to focus on, not just in links into the new employment programmes, although that is really important. We need to make employment a health issue. We need to be having conversations about employment in the primary care sector, in the secondary care sector, where people are well enough to do so. We know that there are some good programmes on employment that we really want to see introduced more in Scotland. So we know that the Individual Placement and Support Programme, which SAMH and others run, has extremely high success rates of getting people into employment and staying in employment. The equalised review in six European countries found that the IPS approach is cheaper, is twice as likely to get people into work, they stay in work for longer, they have better outcomes. And currently IPS is only in 15% of community mental health teams in Scotland. We think there's a bit of an open goal there in terms of something that we can do. We're already doing it. We know it works, and it will help to give people more opportunities, more income, which is really important, more of a sense of control, and start to reduce inequalities. So we really hope there will be a big bit of work on employment in the next strategy. And then secondly, on stigma, which there isn't a great deal about in the discussion document that we had earlier in the year. Sam H with the Mental Health Foundation is very proud to be one of the managing partners of CME, the anti-stigma campaign, which is doing excellent work and which has had really good support from the Scottish Government. But we think that stigma needs to be tackled not just through the programme, through the CME programme, but also at all levels in the mental health system. It continues to be difficult to talk about your mental health and the fact that you may be having problems with your mental health. It is hard to seek help for a mental health problem. And everyone that you might encounter on your journey to try to get that help needs to understand that and to be committed to helping you dismantle the stigma that you might have encountered. And we think that is really important in tackling the inequalities that we see.
Okay, Chris, then Colin.
Sure, just briefly on the employment front. We just done a new piece of research on the experiences of people in work and a bit of an economic analysis on the impact and contribution made by people with mental health problems in the workforce. And we didn't get much media coverage because we went with a positive angle. The media always wants a negative angle. But our economic analysis showed that the value added to UK GDP by people working with mental health problems was 226 billion, or 12.1% of GDP, as compared with a cost, if you like, of around 26 billion. Now, cost and burden and drag is always something you hear in the public narrative about mental health problems. And I'm going to link that quite cunningly into the call that I would have for the committee. We would love to see this committee recognise and call out mental health inequalities as a mainstream inequality that is faced within Scotland and which links to all the other areas of inequality. And back in 2011, with the Christie Commission report into the future of public services, Christie called for an assumption on addressing inequalities, a systematic approach to addressing failure demand and co-production as a means forward. And I still can't think of three better ways to address mental health inequalities as we are. And failure demand is the one that we haven't really touched on in this debate today. And we're at great risk with the pressures we currently face in the fiscal environment we are in, of creating a new generation of failure demand. So if we do what we should do to address inequalities, which is early years support, which is perinatal, which is starting at the beginning of the life course, we can't forget that the child who today is experiencing an adverse childhood event somewhere in this city has 80 years, or probably more likely 60 years, given the challenges of life expectancy ahead of them of failure demand, and we can't forget that either. And that's
Colin and Marie.
Probably reinforcing a couple of points and making one new point. I mean, and certainly around life expectancy, which I think we started off talking about a while ago. I mean, I think, again, in terms of what do we do, this is actually a classic kind of wicked issue. We don't quite know what to do, and there's a lot of things you would have to do. So I think the role of a 10-year strategy is to actually say, we're going to do this. In 10 years' time, we are going to reduce by half, for say, the difference in life expectancy. And, you know, it's like climate change. You know, we don't know how we're going to reach the climate change target, but we've set an ambitious climate change target, and we're going to actually change systems in order to meet it. And that's what we should be doing around life expectancy. And we've done it in the past around suicide. I don't think we set a suicide target. We quite knew how we were going to get the numbers down, but we did get the numbers down, you know, quite substantially. So it's about setting an ambitious goal and working through over 10 years how you actually make that difference. And it will be a lot of different interventions. I mean, the failure demand, I mean, I think it would be very helpful in a strategy, because we know we haven't got any money, to think about where money is being wasted in public services, and that's where people end up in the justice system, costing the police or the courts or the prisons vast amounts of money when they could be supported in crisis in different ways. And I think the point about people in crisis is a classic area where lots of different public service actors get involved and spend a lot of money, but we don't actually help people in crisis very well, and that would be an area of focus. And finally, just on inequalities, I do think it's important that we look at inequalities within mental health as well, and look at who with mental health needs actually does worst out of the current mental health system. And that would be people like people with borderline personality disorder, people with autistic spectrum disorder. I mean, the investigations we've done, you know, it tends not to be people who have bipolar disorder which responds to medication, who get the medication, who are the tragedies. It tends to be people who current services don't meet their needs. If you look at a couple of investigations, and we really need to do better for people with those kind of labels, which are often used to exclude people from services rather than to support them.
Marie.
Thank you very much. I'm particularly interested actually in your submission, which was about the mention of the legislative framework. So we've heard from a couple of people about the difficulty that folk with mental health problems have accessing or utilising SDS. We've also heard about how power is really important and fundamental to our health. And I just wonder if this issue, as you say, this unique issue for mental health where there is non-consensual care, it is maybe part of the fundamental problem. I know that's a real bag of worms, but I'm very interested to know what your thoughts are and how we could improve that.
Well, I think one of the issues which is currently being debated at the UN level, and Lucy mentioned the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. I mean, that's a very challenging document because some of the people behind the UN Convention would say we shouldn't have coercive care at all, and we're not sure we can get there quickly, but I think one of the things that underlies that is how do we actually take decisions for and with people with mental health issues or other mental disabilities? And we recently published a document around supported decision making, and the fundamental kind of change that that's about is historically we've had, I suppose, a system which is based on the idea that you lack insight into your condition, therefore we are going to have to take a decision for you and we will decide what's best for you and you'll just have to take it. Now that's a caricature, but that's the way the law is ultimately framed. Supported decision making is actually about saying we will maximise the extent to which you have some say in your own care and treatment and what matters for you. And this is happening across healthcare generally, that doctors are saying it's not for us to decide what's good for you, it's for you to decide what works for you. And as the Millen principles in the Mental Health Act are already supporting that, and things like advocacy, which is already in the Mental Health Act, support that. But we haven't really done enough to actually make that the lived reality for people who experience the possibility of coercion. As I say, you know, at the moment, within the Commission, we would say it's difficult to do without ultimately saying sometimes people are so unwell, we have to take decisions for them. But the way that we do that, I think, could fundamentally change, and certainly over the next 10 years we should be working out how to do that.
Do you want back in, Marie?
No, I think that's good. If I might pick up on what you said about personality disorders, so being a particularly area where there is unmet need, I just wondered if yourself and other people around the table might want to expand a little bit more on that, on why that's particularly so.
Well, perhaps let other people talk about the detail of it, because I think people like Alistair will have much more to say than I do. But generally, I suppose historically, it's been because there's been a sense that people are labelled as having a personality disorder, don't respond well to medication, that isn't the answer for them. And so it's almost been a kind of exclusionary diagnosis. It's a way of saying, we haven't got anything for you, please go away and sort yourself out. Now that's changing, and I think there are interventions which can support people with personality disorders, but our service systems aren't really terribly well set up to actually deliver those at the moment, but others might want to say a bit more about that.
Chris?
I'd completely echo what Colin said, and I'm sure Alistair has thoughts too, but certainly one of the challenges with increasing access to mental health services is the temptation to provide the simple treatment to the most possible people. And we hear time and again, and I know colleagues do as well, that some of the more complex people, particularly people who have had those adverse childhood experiences, who are living with profound trauma, completely confound the system as it's currently configured. And when that system is at a level of overload, and when those staff are at a level of overload, people who are the most complex and the least empowered are the most let down sometimes by the system that we have, and that has to change.
Alistair.
I agree very much that within the mental health system as such, that there are some people who are better catered for than others, and that people with personality disorders can sometimes very much feel as though that is the bottom of the Cinderella of the Cinderella. And there is evidence now about things that can make a difference. There's increased evidence of the benefits of psychological therapies for people. We know that effective care planning can be very useful, but at the moment the system tends to, where you end up in the system very much depends on where you enter the system. So someone with the same level of difficulties could just as easily end up in the criminal justice system or in a secure forensic mental health unit, or could be being left in the community and being told you don't have a mental health problem and we can't offer anything for you. We do have, the college does have a working group at the moment looking at making some recommendations about how we can get a consistent approach, bringing together, and the college's working group has expanded across a thing called the Personality Disorder Network, which is a multi-agency organisation. I expect them to report early in 2017, and the college would certainly be looking to have a campaign to improve the supports for people with personality disorder next year. But really what they will be doing, I hope, is pulling together the evidence from the different services that we have across Scotland, some of which are producing some good outcomes, and that we'll be able to then to use that to suggest to other areas of Scotland how they might proceed.
Okay, we're almost at the end of our time. I'll go round every other contributors and ask them to give us the one thing that Alison requested that we include in the report. But I've got one final point to yourself, Alistair, and it's in relation to your submission, where you say services are struggling with significant issues created by ongoing requirements for efficiency savings and the impact on health and social integration budgets. If it was efficiency savings, then the service would be getting better. So are these efficiencies that are being applied, therefore the service is getting better, or are they something else that we're calling efficiencies?
Okay, just to use my own day job as an example, we'd be in a situation where our mental health service has a budget in the region of 55 to 60 million per year. The health board would apply an efficiency across that of, last year we looked at 5% in terms of the efficiency across that. Now, we have seen some investment in mental health services. So what's coming out is roughly 3 million. What's coming in has been something like 1.2 million. So we're seeing a 1.8 million deficit in our mental health services this year. That 1.8 million deficit isn't then being reapplied into mental health services. It is dealing with the overall health board budget. And the same is happening with local authority colleagues. And of course, the biggest focus for health boards is naturally the thing that which they get most pressure on, and they get most pressure on how they are dealing with unscheduled care, accident and emergency waiting times, and the waiting times within the acute sector.
All of us on this committee have got our own particular bee in our bonnet, and this is mine, right? So are they efficiencies or are they cuts?
There are cuts in the budget to mental health services.
Thank you. Okay, Miles, did you want in on that?
Quickly around, gatekeepers for adults in Scotland, which we've not really had a chance to touch upon today. And specifically, I wanted to ask two points for the panel to sort of very briefly touch upon. Firstly, do you think, and how do you think, the link workers are going to help to improve service and signpost people to the correct treatments? And also, given the fact we've seen such a huge increase in prescriptions for drugs to help treat mental health, do you actually believe there's people in Scotland being prescribed medications around mental health who actually should be signposted towards alternative psychological therapies?
Can I ask, when we answer Miles, that we also Right, so we'll do that. If you don't want to answer Mel's question, then you can skip that and just give us your one point. But if you want to roll the two, then that would be really helpful. Bob, you want to go first? You're lucky you can go first.
Thank you, Mr. Meener. Yes, I think we need to have much more support for the third sector organisations working and helping to self-manage conditions. But very importantly, equal access to employment will support the improved aspirations of people with mental health, particularly as we see a revision of the welfare system is currently being undertaken, and it's going to have a great impact on those with mental health and mental incapacity, and the challenge of helping those caught up in those systems and impacts of change navigate the very complex landscape that is now emerging in the social welfare field.
Okay, Carolyn.
So on the question of primary care, we think the links workers are really important. We think they will help a lot to have people get quicker access to services. We would like to see some different models of links workers tried out, whether that's people being as part of a cluster or located in-house. We'd like to see some different approaches being tested. There's a commitment to 250 new links workers. The recent Fairer Scotland document did mention that only 40 of them will be in place by 2018. We think that is maybe a little bit slow. We'd quite like to see some more in place by then. But we definitely think that all GP surgeries in Scotland should have access to a links worker. In terms of the second part of your question, we want to see better access to things like psychological therapies. We want people to have greater choice. We do think that medication absolutely has an important place and is really important for many people. We often find that the reporting around the stats on particularly antidepressant figures and frankly some of the political debate around those figures is not that helpful. People should have the choice to have whatever evidence-based treatment and support they agree with their healthcare provider, but they certainly should have a very broad range of options. And on the one thing that we would like to see, we think that the biggest thing that could be done as part of the next strategy is to transform the culture of our mental health services, but also our education and employment services, so that people really genuinely can ask once and get help fast.
Chris?
Yeah, I certainly echo Carolyn's sentiment, and in terms of link workers, I think there's a critical role to play in brokering connections to the system for people who don't know how to interface with that system. In young people, there's the one good adult theme, and that sometimes applies to people who are very excluded or marginalised as adults as well. And we see in recovery that often a strong relationship with a good and supportive person, regardless of what their professional role is quite often the thing that helps people forward. And I think, in a sense, that may well help with some of what is undoubtedly some unnecessarily prescribing, where people don't feel able to access the other things that are available for them. In terms of our one point, well, I'm going to say prevention, aren't I? I think a critical thing that this committee could do in terms of pushing the direction of the strategy is to free mental health from the constricts of being just regarded as a specialist health issue and anchor it in all policies without compromising the need for innovation and resource in mental health services for those who need them.
Andrew.
Thanks. On the link workers, we are doing some work in evaluating the value of link workers, and that will be due out fairly soon. The question I would raise over that is, how professional do they need to be? I think there's a lot to be said for peer help. There's a lot to be said for youth workers, not a professional workforce as we conventionally regard them, but they've got an awful lot to offer. Evidence-based and behind youth workers is not great, but we should do something about that. Good adults, I like that point, and I would echo that. On the one thing I would say, it's a bit of a dodge, but I'd say really a full cream implementation of the Christie principles. And okay, that includes prevention and other things, but there's a report hanging in there which we haven't really taken on and lived. And if we could actually look at the Christie principles and apply them to mental health as we could apply them to other areas of public service, we'd get some places. And I'd start young people, very young people, young adults. They're the ones that we really need to nurture.
Colin.
On the linked workers, we recently did a team visit to people with severe and enduring mental illness living in the community, and one of the kind of big things for us was that actually the people we saw, they were getting their medication, they were kind of being kept well enough so they weren't having to go back in a hospital. But a lot of people were leading very, very impoverished lives, and it was, you know, they were isolated, they weren't in accessing the jobs market. So it is about thinking more broadly than about, you know, are you psychotic today, and into how do we actually help you flourish. And it's about rediscovering some of the values of social work from back in the 1960s, about actually helping people in community to live flourishing lives that contribute to society, and link workers and those kind of things can help with that. In terms of the one big thing about the strategy, I mean, without being sarcastic, I'd like it to be a real strategy. And I think what, you know, if we look at, we published a report with the Human Rights Commission on human rights and mental health care, and one of the things we published that was a diagram of a kind of logic model which said, within a few years, this is what we're trying to do. It's about service users and carers enacting their rights. A Scotland where care is person-centred and self-directed, free of stigma and discrimination, and which recovery is a reality for all. And we actually had to set out, well, what are the medium-term outcomes that would contribute to that? What are the kind of shorter-term outcomes that contribute to that? And what are the actions that get there? And actually, do we believe that the things that we're doing are going to get there? And I think my worry about often about public services, it's easy to announce something which isn't a bad thing, but if you actually say, is that going to achieve that outcome? You have to say, well, don't know, or probably not. So I think the strategy, if it's going to be a 10-year strategy, needs to have that level of ambition and focus.
Thanks, Lucy.
Well, thanks very much for the question about the links workers, because I was hoping for an opportunity to to mention them as one of the organisations that's kind of led on the National Link Worker Programme. I mean, we're delighted with what it's achieved. And I think the only point that I would add to what everybody else has said is that obviously, you know, one of the things about the Link Worker Programme is that it is actually quite a transformational approach to primary care, because it isn't just about the relationship between the community practitioner, the links practitioner, and the people accessing the service and the practice that they're then being directed to. It's actually about transforming the culture within primary care itself, and the nature of how primary care, inverted commas, is delivered. So it's one of those things, again, those practical things that we could do to transform our approach to mental health as well as the wider health and wellbeing agenda. My one takeaway is, unsurprisingly, about rights. Basically, we would love it for the committee to sort of call upon the next strategy to be not only explicitly based around human rights, the human rights-based approach, actually developed using a human rights-based approach, so on a co-production basis, for example, with people who access services, supports, and unpaid carers, that it's built on a framework of human rights, and actually there's explicit reference made to human rights and human rights standards in its commitments, and that will be measured against those human rights indicators, and that also that it might even extend as far as looking at human rights budgeting approaches to how we actually finance and fund the delivery of supports and services, whether it's in the public sector or by, you know, not forgetting the vast majority of services and supports that are actually delivered by the third sector in mental health. Thanks.
And also,
okay. A lot said already about the link workers. I think that we are at a time when we need to see transformation within primary care. General practice is struggling, and that if we can get a better system for accessing mental health services within practices, that's going to be hugely helpful for everybody. Including general practice colleagues. Just mention the antidepressant thing. I do have concerns when we tend to look at this in a black and white system and say antidepressants are a bad thing. Antidepressants are a great thing if they're the right thing for you. And so what's really important is that we encourage the identification of mental health problems that will benefit from antidepressants at the same time as offering psychological therapies. And psychological therapies and antidepressants can sometimes be the right treatment. It's not one or the other. We sometimes need both. In terms of the big ask, from my perspective, it would be parity. It would be that we should treat mental health, not just we have in the law already in Scotland in the NHS Act something that says that mental and physical health should be equally regarded, and I think that's there, but we need genuine parity in terms of thinking about the resource that's applied to mental health, the attention that's applied to mental health, and our understanding of better mental health in our whole community.
Okay, thanks very much. Could I thank all the participants this morning? I'm sure I speak for the committee when I say that I found that exceptionally helpful. And thank you very much. Can I suspend briefly?